Blackstone Audio presents The Consolations of Philosophy by Alain de Botton. Part 1. Consolation for Unpopularity. Chapter 1. A few years ago, during a bitter New York winter, with an afternoon to spare before catching a flight to London, I found myself in a deserted gallery on the upper level of the Metropolitan Museum of Art. It was brightly lit and, aside from the soothing hum of an underfloor heating system, entirely silent. Having reached a surfeit of paintings in the Impressionist galleries, I was looking for a sign for the cafeteria, where I hoped to buy a glass of a certain variety of American chocolate milk of which I was at that time extremely fond, when my eye was caught by a canvas which a caption explained had been painted in Paris in the autumn of 1786 by the 38-year-old Jacques-Louis David. Socrates, condemned to death by the people of Athens, prepares to drink a cup of hemlock, surrounded by woebegone friends. In the spring of 399 BC, three Athenian citizens had brought legal proceedings against the philosopher. They had accused him of failing to worship the city's gods, of introducing religious novelties, and of corrupting the young men of Athens. And such was the severity of their charges, they had called for the death penalty. Socrates had responded with legendary equanimity. Though afforded an opportunity to renounce his philosophy in court, he had sided with what he believed to be true rather than what he knew would be popular. In Plato's account, he had defiantly told the jury, "So long as I draw breath and have my faculties, I shall never stop practicing philosophy and exhorting you and elucidating the truth for everyone that I meet. And so, gentlemen, whether you acquit me or not, you know that I am not going to alter my conduct, not even if I have to die 100 deaths." And so he had been led to meet his end in an Athenian jail, his death marking a defining moment in the history of philosophy. An indication of its significance may be the frequency with which it has been painted. In 1650, the French painter Charles-Alphonse Dufresnoy produced a Death of Socrates now hanging in the Galleria Palatina in Florence, which has no cafeteria. The 18th century witnessed the zenith of interest in Socrates' death, particularly after Diderot drew attention to its painterly potential in a passage in his Treatise on Dramatic Poetry. Jacques-Louis David received his commission in the spring of 1786 from Charles-Michel Trudaine de la Sablière, a wealthy member of the Parlement and a gifted Greek scholar. The terms were generous: 6,000 livres up front and a further 3,000 on delivery. Louis XVI had paid only 6,000 livres for the larger Oath of the Horatii. When the picture was exhibited at the Salon of 1787, it was at once judged the finest of the Socratic ends. Sir Joshua Reynolds thought it the most exquisite and admirable effort of art which has appeared since the Capella Sistina and the Stanza of Raphael. The picture would have done honour to Athens in the age of Pericles. I bought 5 postcard Davids in the museum gift shop, and later, flying over the ice fields of Newfoundland, turned a luminous green by a full moon and a cloudless sky, examined one while picking at a pale evening meal left on the table in front of me by a stewardess during a misjudged snooze. Plato sits at the foot of the bed, a pen and a scroll beside him, silent witness to the injustice of the state. He had been 29 at the time of Socrates' death, but David turned him into an old man, grey-haired and grave. Through the passageway, Socrates' wife, Xanthippe, is escorted from the prison cell by warders. 7 friends are in various stages of lamentation. Socrates' closest companion, Crito, seated beside him, gazes at the master with devotion and concern. But the philosopher, bolt upright, with an athlete's torso and biceps, shows neither apprehension nor regret. That a large number of Athenians have denounced him as foolish has not shaken him in his convictions. David had planned to paint Socrates in the act of swallowing poison, but the poet, André Chénier, suggested that there would be greater dramatic tension if he was shown finishing a philosophical point while at the same time reaching serenely for the hemlock that would end his life, symbolizing both obedience...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.